the logistics. Time permitting, we will attempt to take some questions at the very end, and so we'll go from there. Like to briefly, without having long introductions, just briefly introduce our panel of guest speakers to talk on this topic. So to my far right, we have Dr. Susan Aronson, who is a research professor of international affairs at George Washington University, who's written 5 books on trade and 1 on global corporate social responsibility, and is a frequent commentator on all of the issues we'll be discussing today. On my immediate right is Dr. Claude Barfield, resident scholar at AEI, American Enterprise Institute, also a former consultant to the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative. TPP and potentially on NAFTA today. Okay, with that, Susan Lund, let's start by briefly discussing the growth and importance of digital trade in the United States and the global economies. McKinsey's put together a very comprehensive study updated in 2016 on digital globalization. We could talk about the study all hour, but could you briefly summarize the key findings in terms of growth in digital trade and barriers to continued growth?
Yeah, thank you. It's an honor to be here. So I will try to briefly summarize what we found. We looked at globalization writ large, all types of flows of goods and services, people, finance, and data flows. And what we found, So what we found in this study is that if you look at the trading goods, which is getting a lot of the backlash today and a lot of the focus is what's happened to manufacturing goods and trade and jobs, and what you see is that since the Great Recession in 2008 and 9, global trade in goods has actually flattened. It has not grown faster than global GDP, and this is a sharp trend break from what you saw in the previous 20 years where global trade in goods was growing roughly twice as fast as GDP every year. So at first we thought, well, this is just post-crisis recession, it's a secular decline or a cyclical decline, and we looked into it and said, well, now we're 5, 6, 7 years of flat global trade growth, something different is happening. And indeed, when you look at different industries, sector by sector, what you can see is that the rapid expansion of global value chains and supply chains around the world that occurred over the last 20 years has more or less played out. So the supply chains that exist are more or less there. They're not exponentially growing faster than the final goods product. So it's an irony that given the political debates we've had in this country over the last year, that there's a lot of focus on goods trade and trade agreements, when in fact, we see that that era of globalization is already waning. And instead, what's taking its place is what we call digital trade. And that includes all sorts of cross-border data flows. When you look at just the volume of bits and bytes flowing across national borders, it's grown 45 times in the last 10 years. Cisco, that collects the data, projects it's going to grow another 9 times in volume over the next 5 years. So what this encompasses is all different sorts of communication. Some of it is individual, for instance, cross-border e-commerce, which is projected to reach $1 trillion worth of trade, and that's just business-to-consumer e-commerce. Business-to-business cross-border e-commerce is roughly 2x as large. It includes free services like Skype, which is now nearly half of all international call minutes take place over Skype itself, the platform. It includes information searches, but it also has an even more important business-to-business component, and that is both within global companies that have centralized parts of their operations, say their research labs, R&D, or back office functions like accounting and HR, in specific countries, and data is flowing to different offices around the world. And it's also business to business and the Internet of Things. So today, we have, for instance, oil rigs in the North Sea that are pinging bits of data about the performance back to headquarters in London. If you drive a Japanese car in this country, your car is sending bits of data on its performance back to Japan for analysts to look at and improve the performance. If you have children who like to play Xbox, guess what? That information is also being collected. So the cross-border data flows and what we call digital trade, it encompasses a lot of different activities. But collectively, we did a lot of econometrics, and happily, I won't describe it to you. I'll just tell you the result, which is that overall, countries that are open to all sorts of global flows have raised their GDP by at least 10%, and about half of that impact alone is just from data flows. So it's now worth as much to countries as cross-border trade in goods. And that means that the next era of trade policy needs to take into account things that might stop the free flow of data, things we call data protectionism. And these can be micro policies. This can be data localization. It can be not recognizing different standards of privacy and how we treat consumer and individual information. It can be things like actual internet blocking, China's Great Wall and censorship. I think cybersecurity is going to be increasingly important as well. As we know, it's hard to stay one step ahead of the hackers, and that's an area where cross-border and international cooperation would definitely be called for. So I will stop there and say that without a doubt, digital trade is the next frontier, and it's what's driving global economic growth.
Thank you, Susan. That's an excellent overview, and hopefully we can hit most to all of those issues in the next hour. Meredith, also in terms of overview, can you discuss the International Trade Commission's recent studies of the trade economy and the digital trade economy and what opportunities there are for U.S. companies and industries there?
Thanks, Tim. I work for the International Trade Commission, and we're sort of a research think tank function for the government on trade issues. Our main clients are the Senate Finance Committee and the House Ways and Means Committee, and also USTR. In 2013 and 2014, did two studies, which in this sector are almost long in the tooth now when I think about it. But it was sort of context and research, I think, that helped prepare the members of Congress and the administration for what resulted in the TPP agreement. And we looked across the economy and tried to paint a picture and bring some research together that would inform the members and the negotiators. And none of the findings are all that surprising at this point, and just echo what Susan said in the sense that the U.S. is a world leader in the ICT sector. We just have a huge economic footprint across the globe. The big five leaders in this part of the economy are Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, Google, and Facebook. They're all U.S.-based, and they're competing very aggressively with each other in our market in all different aspects of this sector. We took a quantitative snapshot of the size of the market. U.S. firms reported almost $1 trillion of sales in goods and services in 2012, which I'm sure is much bigger at this point, and about a quarter of this was in U.S. exports. Looking at the global footprint of U.S. digital trade, we found that almost half of U.S. global exports and imports are with the EU, which is about twice the level with the Asia Pacific. And that digital trade was having a significant positive growth effect on the U.S. economy, which, of course, is no surprise. It enhances productivity and is likely to increase U.S. GDP each year about 3.4% to 4.8%. But that was a one-year snapshot based on our research, and have to keep looking at that in the future. Leads to higher real wages and a potential increase of almost 2.4 million jobs per year. The last aspect of a report looked at the trade barriers out there that are facing digital firms, and a lot of these were addressed in the TPP agreement, localization requirement, market access limitations, data privacy and protection barriers that U.S. firms are facing. So this was kind of a context and a little bit of a history on, I think, how U.S. negotiators and the President and Congress got to what ended up being the digital trade provisions in the TPP.
Excellent. Thank you. Now for the rest of our panel, Claude and Ari and Susan Aronson, the U.S., let's turn to our breaking news. The United States was trying to eliminate digital trade barriers in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Trade Agreement which has been, which President Trump has now officially withdrawn the United States from. Can you give an overview of the TPP provisions on e-commerce and digital trade? And if TPP is dead, where do we go next? Claude, can you start us on that?
Sure. Well, and thank you very much for inviting me. Well, to build on the Susan's points and Mara's points, I think, in effect, what the president has done this morning, and one of probably going to be several foolish moves, has taken really taken the underpinning out of what was the beginnings of a legal regime, international trade legal regime, for digital trade. Because with the exception of hortatory provisions in the U.S.-Korea agreement, this is the first agreement, and I think some others can challenge me, I don't know of all the other bilaterals around the world, and there are hundreds, but I don't think, as far as I know, anyone has actually tackled trade digital trade barriers or made them legally binding. As Meredith pointed out, the major provisions, and it's only a beginning, it is the legal foundation, but a very important foundation in the TPP, had to do with assuring the free flow of data. It forbade data localization. It forbade forcing the United States or any other country to transfer technology digital related technology as a means of doing business in a particular country. It banned tariffs on digital goods. It made non-discrimination. It also had allowed countries to, it provided for privacy and consumer protection relations. It did not dictate to a country what the level of privacy or what the provisions of privacy or consumer protection would be, but it did say that you had to have provisions, rules or regulations and legislation in those two areas. And so basically what it was the first in terms of important international agreements that began to set a legal foundation for digital trade. And now with the TPP having gone, that has now been swept away. So the Trump administration is starting from zero, as it were, in terms of digital trade rules with whatever else it does. Let me finish by just two other points. The president has now also said that he wants to renegotiate NAFTA. There are two things about that. One, we already have a renegotiation of NAFTA in the TPP, but that leads me to the second. And here, there's at least one ray of hope in one of the hearings, confirmation hearings from the Secretary of Treasury Mnuchin, who basically said in answer to a question, we should start with NAFTA provisions with TPP provisions when we look to renegotiate NAFTA. That could not be more important in terms of the digital trade areas, the digital rules that are in the TPP. Hopefully, the administration will take at least some of his advice, at least on a sub rosa basis, even if they don't admit that they're doing it formally or publicly. So I think I'll leave it there.
Great. All right, your thoughts on TPP and
yeah, thanks,
where we're headed?
And just want to echo appreciation of Max and Tim and others that have put the panel together, and Tim for moderating. And in addition to, is it a little bit closer? Yeah. So in addition to the points that Claude just made on data flows and localization and customs duties on digital goods and services, I think that the other piece that I want to make sure is not forgotten that was in TPP, which again, as mentioned, was really the highest internationally agreed standard on digital trade issues that we've seen to date, is the balanced IP frameworks that were included on copyright. And that included safe harbors on intermediary liability, and then also limitations and exceptions, which has brought us closer to fair use, which is the system that we rely on here in the U.S. and digital services rely on to ensure that they're able to mine data and index the web for search purposes and otherwise. So again, I just want to make sure that's part of the conversation here in terms of the full digital package that was agreed upon in the TPP. But shifting a little bit, yes, unfortunate news this morning that some of these provisions have been set aside for now, but I do think that the structure of TPP really gives us the basis and the starting point for upcoming negotiations, whether it is NAFTA, whether it is US-UK agreement, or as we're looking towards other multilateral agreements like the WTO, which has taken a big interest in e-commerce issues, that we can start to look at some of these models that have been put in place and really borrow from them and make digital trade work for everyone, essentially. And I know that it's been discussed already, kind of the applications. I want to make sure that the small business perspective isn't forgotten, and the online sellers that are really in basements across the country that are all of a sudden, they may have 1,500 people in their local community that they're able to sell to in person. But once they go digital, once they start accessing digital platforms, internet platforms, they're able to all of a sudden have access to over 180 markets in some cases, all really overnight. And the barriers to international trade have never been lower. Right now, we're looking at payment processing is easy across borders. We're looking at translation services. We're looking at marketing being a lot easier on Facebook or YouTube or other services. Really, right now, there's no better time to be a small business and being able to rely on the internet to sell your goods.
Excellent. Thank you. Susan Aronson, for moving forward on new digital trade rules in free trade agreements, what other issues or concerns should we be considering, or any thoughts you have on TPP as well?
Well, I first of all, thank you, Tim and Max, for organizing this panel and for inviting me, and nice to see all of you here. I want to make two broad points. I do mourn the loss of TPP. I think it was a great start in terms of trying to define rules governing information flows. But that said, I want to be an optimist and say perhaps there's an opportunity to redo this in a thoughtful way. And what I mean by that is, first of all, TPP covered 25% of internet users. So it would have been very forceful on the global internet. But the platform is global, and hence, at least whether we adopt principles or we adopt rules, binding rules that are disputable, we really need to find a way to do that globally. That's the first thing. The second thing is, because the platform is global and because the internet has always been governed by an ad hoc, multi-stakeholder approach, many internet activists have viewed using trade agreements as a strategy to achieve rules governing information flows. They viewed it quite negatively, and I think that's understandable because the process is secret. But that said, there are reasons why the process has been done in secret. However, we need to talk about this. So that's one broad point. The other point I wanted to make, just very quickly, is digital protectionism is a very new concept. One of the things that I really liked about TPP is the definition of digital protectionism in TPP was very narrow. It looked to server location requirements, local content requirements, that kind of thing, where it's really clearly, you could clearly see that it was distorting trade among producers or governments, right, providers of services. But here's the thing. The United States government responds to companies that say, we think content requirements are protectionist. We think privacy requirements in this country are inadequate, or they're too much in another country, right? The right to delinked. There is no global consensus on whether or not these things are protectionist or legitimate regulation. So that's going to be a real quandary. Is the right to delink a barrier to trade? It sure looks that way, but we don't know because there's never been a trade dispute on that kind of regulation. On too much privacy regulations, not enough. Another one would be China's recent actions related to apps of media sources like the New York Times. They banned that from the Apple App Store in China. Is that a barrier to trade? Could be, but we just don't know until we have trade disputes. I'll shut up now, but that would provide guidance to negotiators as we seek to develop these rules governing trade.
Thank you. Any other last thoughts on TPP from our panel or the definition of digital trade?
The only thing I would argue is I don't disagree with Susan, but first things first, as she said at the beginning of her statement, she supported the TPP. I don't think the TPP was the be-all and the end-all, but it did provide a the beginnings of a legal foundation, which was quite important, as our other commentators have pointed out, particularly to the U.S. economy. And secondly, looking forward, I do not see, I wouldn't say in my lifetime, I'm older than most of you here, but I don't see in the next few years we're going to get World Trade Organization rules on the internet or digital trade or anything else. So you just have to, you have to start with building blocks. And the TPP did encompass about 40% of world GDP and about 30% of world trade. And then when you add in the Korea, the Philippines, probably Indonesia later, Colombia are already standing at the door to get in. So it would have been an incremental, quite an important addition, even without the new countries that would inevitably have come in. Korea within a year. Excuse me, go ahead.
No, very good. Please.
Tim, if I may.
Of course.
Just one thing, as the internet is growing at the rapid pace that it is, I think that we have to be a little bit careful to box ourselves in on defining what digital protectionism is, and I think that we need to make sure that it's really, we're looking at barriers to U.S. digital trade, and that's going to come in many, many different forms, and one market may mean something, and another market may mean something else. But I also think that with the rapid pace of innovation, we don't want to define something now that in a few years may be obsolete. So I think that as we're focused on barriers to digital trade, I just think that we need to keep that very, very broad and to ensure that we're really able to ensure that companies are able to trade in the future.
Good.
I think Ari's making a really important point. We want to come up with rules that are technologically neutral, but I just want to give you the reality of what's happening in the United States right now. Right now, there is a case related to U.S. Steel. U.S. Steel has I said that I totally agree we want to come up with a system of rules that's technologically neutral, which means they can accommodate technological change, new products, new services. But right now, companies are alleging digital protectionism. And in one particular case, a company, U.S. Steel, has said that its high-tech steel, the plants for that high-tech steel were stolen through cyber theft, and therefore the company deserves trade relief. And I just want you to think about that. How would the U.S. government determine, because right now the U.S. government entities often hire private sector firms to determine attribution. So how would the U.S. government determine first attribution? Okay, who stole it? Why did they steal it? Did they steal it to gain a competitive advantage in the market? How would we know that? And then how do you put in remedies to address this problem? The U.S. government, I see no evidence that the U.S. government has come up with a strategy to deal with that. So we do need to talk about it as we seek to negotiate trade policies.
I know, so I don't want to get into weeds here. I know something about the U.S. Steel case because I also covered it. But if the government were to get into it, you could use the Trade Secrets Act. And the other thing is that U.S. Steel, whether or not there, I don't know, maybe Meredith would know more about this, whether or not the U.S. Steel case is actually correct, but they have for the first time, this is very difficult stuff, as Susan said, attribution, they have for the first time that I have seen, which is why I'm surprised that the U.S. government itself has been more involved, because we did go against some Chinese, the military there, on the basis of intellectual property. I'm surprised they haven't gotten in it, but they haven't. But U.S. Steel, in its case, shows the new technology they had when it was stolen and when it came on the Chinese market. That is a very difficult thing, usually, to follow. So, and you could do it, whether you should do it through the ITC or just the Trade Secrets Act, I don't know. But we do have the beginnings of ways to go against companies or countries who violate, certainly, that part of intellectual property.
All good points. I'll mention portions of that U.S. Steel. Well, the U.S. Steel case is pending in front of the International Trade Commission, so Commissioner Broadbent's definitely not going to be able to touch that one today or anytime soon. But Let's move to more macro, and I'll ask a question that no one on this panel can answer, I don't think, so with any clarity, and that is, what does a Trump administration think about digital trade, and who's going to take the lead on these issues among USTR, the Commerce Department, this new National Trade Council? Again, Susan Lund, can we start with you?
Well, you're right. I don't have a clear answer.
Good luck.
And even if I did, I probably couldn't say it on the record publicly. I will say there are a couple important things to keep in mind. I mean, so the Commerce Department has started a number of initiatives on measuring the digital economy, which I would hope would be continued. It is the Commerce Department controls the or runs the Bureau of Economic Analysis that produces all the GDP statistics and all the data that people like me use. And so under the last administration, they have started a very important new effort to get their arms around what do we even mean by the digital economy, of which digital trade and cross-border is a portion, and how do we measure it, and is it being captured and reflected? And I would certainly hope that initiatives like that, that would seem to me to be bipartisan, would continue to be supported. I'm afraid, though, that I think the point that the internet is a global thing, and it's rapidly evolving, I'm afraid that a lot of the policies that are being suggested are too backward-looking and focusing on the losers of globalization, which is not to say that they're not out there and deserve help, but help should not come in the form of protectionism, but rather reskilling, job retraining, relocating, and actually improving people's livelihoods. When it comes to the trade front, I would hope that we keep our eyes looking ahead and not behind, and so bring up the TPP and improve upon it and realize that digital trade and trade in services is really where the future is at.
Others on the panel, thoughts on where this administration might be or where to look to get a sense of that?
Well, I'd like to comment on that. And one of the things is that the tech workforce, as you know, is often comprised of what we call contingent workers, which means people without contracts and benefits. And one thing that the new Trump administration could do could be to include in the labor chapter of any new trade agreements provisions helping those workers who are so much of the workforce for companies in the United States and Europe and other countries. So that would be a good thing because more and more of us will work like that. Another phenomenon that's going on because of the internet economy is maybe you're familiar with platforms like Amazon's Mechanical Turk, where jobs are sort of partialed into pieces. And, you know, this is the future of work, and trade agreements don't talk about these things right now. They are very helpful to unionize workers or workers who might lose their jobs because of trade. But the bulk of workers who lose their job lose their jobs to technology. So we got to figure out a way to help workers in other spheres. And one thing I have to say is that the internet community has been trying to be thoughtful about those things, whereas I don't see trade policymakers being as thoughtful and creative about those things, and I hope that'll change. You have to think about trade agreements as something that's very integrated, and you know, all the chapters mesh, and they have to be coherent. So new ideas related to that allow companies to treat workers as best they can, help them be productive, and help them find new opportunities, that would be a good thing.
I would just say that in terms of digital trade, the Trade Promotion Authority bill was passed last year, and or not 2 years ago, is that at this point? So I think that there is a framework in place that Congress has put their stamp on of what digital trade should look like in trade agreements, and I would just hope that the new administration leans in on that. It sounds like there are, in various statements that have come out, it seems like there are folks within the administration that would embrace Trade Promotion Authority. So I'm hopeful that some of the early guidance can be taken from that piece of legislation, and that as we're looking at who's going to actually be doing the negotiating, who's going to be doing what, where, how, and when, I think that that's obviously going to be a point that will be figured out in the future. But I do think that at a very baseline level, we have some of these provisions in place that we can hopefully rely on.
Very good. Maybe we can get a little more specific now, starting with NAFTA. In his confirmation hearings last week, Commerce Secretary nominee Wilbur Ross indicated that NAFTA would be a first priority for the new administration. We've all been watching our smartphones to see if any notification on NAFTA renegotiation has officially happened yet. That's expected today as well. Claude, maybe start with you. Should NAFTA be, and you started to talk about this, should NAFTA be modified to include new digital trade and e-commerce provisions, and how would that happen?
Well, I already said that Mnuchin, in his confirmation hearings, pointed the direction, but I have no idea how much, to the larger point of your last question, we don't know who's going to really be controlling trade or trade policy. Trump has set up competing potential sources of power in the Commerce Department and this new trade council, which is governed by fools, I would say. And then the USTR. Robert Lighthizer is a tough, from all we know of him in the last several decades, a tough bureaucratic infighter. So it's not likely that he will willingly give up negotiating. Who will do the other part, we don't know. In terms of digital trade, as I said, I'm repeating myself, so I won't go on here. If they want to update NAFTA, they have an update that's already that's we already have in front of us, which is the TPP. They may not want to do everything in the TPP. But in terms of digital trade, I think one of the good things is I don't think they have an opinion one way or the other. It's one of the things, thank God, Trump did not comment on. He did not blight this area with his stupidity about trade. So nor did the Secretary of Commerce or others. So, you know, they've got to do something positive. So it would be sensible of them to push, as the most enlightened new administration, digital trade, because it is the new frontier. I would cheer that, certainly. So we don't know, but it's not something that they've already sort of taken the feet from under because of the negative comments that they've made. So there is start to be hopeful a bit.
There's some room to run maybe on that. Rest of the panel, where else could we look for digital trade and other trade talks, either ongoing talks or potentially new trade agreements?
Well, I should say the UK probably, from what I know of it, I think we would have had a real problem in getting what we got in the TPP in the so-called TTIP, the US-European agreement, which is now just kind of hanging without knowing. I don't think that would, because of French and Germans. Mm-hmm. I think the UK may have a very different attitude, so there may not be as big a problem, I'm guessing, with digital trade issues, the kinds of things you got in the TPP in a UK-US mm-hmm. FTA. You got to remember, though, that's 2 years off. They got to get out of the EU before they can actually sign anything with the United States.
So I would just say on NAFTA, I think it's actually a big opportunity in front of us on digital trade. When NAFTA was negotiated, the late 80s, early 90s, I mean, where were we? Like, the World Wide Web was just being launched. Mozilla was in development. I don't think in the full NAFTA text, I don't think the word internet was actually used in the entire agreement. So we've obviously come a long way, and since that time, we've also passed some landmark pieces of legislation in the U.S. that we have leaned on in trade agreements, one of them being the DMCA in 1999, then also the CDA in 1996, Communications Decency Act. So I think that those are places that we can really look to expand, and specifically on the Communications and Decency Act, I think Section 230 on intermediary liability, non-intellectual property related, is a huge place that we could look at pulling into the NAFTA renegotiation. I think really this is something that internet services rely on across the board. It's given the ability to our biggest companies and smallest companies huge growth potential. So I really hope that is something that we can build on if a NAFTA renegotiation happens. And I say build on because there was a proposal in the Trade and Services Agreement, the TISA agreement, that was tabled in this space. And I think that there is a possibility that this is a place that we could look into.
The other thing to keep in mind is that Mexico and Canada have already agreed to the TPP provisions. I don't know whether the parliament in each has actually ratified it, but they intend to do so. So the governments actually have agreed to what's in that we've been talking about in the TPP already. So you would start with that as a positive.
I'm glad there was a mention of TISA. We do have ongoing in Geneva trade and services agreement negotiations. Now it's, I think, about 25 countries, and clearly in the confirmation hearings last week, there was a strong preference expressed for bilateral deals as opposed to multilateral. But any thoughts on prospects for TISA or other free trade agreements on this panel?
I don't know if I'll weigh in on prospects, but I do think that industry perspective is that TISA is a really, really important agreement. And that's an agreement we would hope to see picked up by the new administration, and I think a lot of our trading partners would like to see it picked up as well. I was in Brussels last week and spoke to a few individuals about TISA, and I think that there's really a sense that if this new administration wants to pick it up, there would still be a huge amount of interest in continuing the conversations. So we're hopeful that that can actually be something that would continue.
Yeah, let me add to that to say, clearly that would be a way of looking forward, not backward. It would be great to pick up and expand upon. And to be aspirational, why not think about a single digital market for North America like the EU is pursuing, and go beyond the TPP digital chapter? And if we're going to renegotiate NAFTA, let's make it possible to do business for our internet giants and other companies to do business as if we're in a single digital market like the EU is trying to create.
But that runs up right against Mr. Trump's point about exporting jobs abroad, which challenges the supply chains. And so it'll be interesting to see. I agree fully, of course. But it'll be interesting to see if they would buy that. They're talking about America first, and that does not include Canada, and it does not include Mexico, as far as we know now. So I hope you're right. It's certainly the way to go. We already have it. There is a North American market. So, but I'm very nervous about that, about their reaction, they are being the administration, whoever that is now, reacting to that, to the thought of a North American market, digital or anything else.
Okay. Susan.
So there is a path around it, which you may have heard of. The IDEA, it's called the IDEA, and it's an international digital economy agreement. That's another, you could do sectoral agreements. The Clinton administration, excuse me, I misspoke. Yeah, they started the hated ATCA, which everyone knows was fought. This is the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement, which related to online copyright, trademarks, et cetera. But so you could do that, and I think, correct me if I'm wrong, that is justified under fast track, that there is language in there allowing a sectoral agreement. So I think a way around it to do something digital, and I think I'm hopeful that whatever you think of Trump administration appointees, I'm hopeful that they will get significant pressure and respond to that pressure to do something that encourages information flows, which could be very human rights enhancing as well as business enhancing if it's done right.
I think you're right. Clearly, in the area of services, there's more room for sectoral agreements than on goods, for instance. So, Meredith, before I forget, one of the last acts of USTR Froman before wrapping up was to request that the commission conduct a new study on digital trade. Can you, and some folks may not know about that, can you talk about what that will be and what information you're looking for from industry?
Yeah, thank you. January 13th, last week, Ambassador Froman engaged the International Trade Commission to do a three-part project with three reports to update and extend the analysis that we did in 2013 and 2014. So we'll be building on our prior work, and these investigations will provide additional insight into the global competitiveness of U.S. digitally intensive industries, and will assist U.S. negotiators in their assessment of the impact of barriers on trade and digital products and services, such as cloud data, software services, data analytics, new internet communication services, and digital services supporting various production processes, as well as trade in manufactured goods connected by data networks and supported by digitally enabled services. So smart manufacturing, trying to get some sense of what the digital environment is able to add to the way the U.S. manufactures goods. There'll be, as I said, there's three parts to this project. The first one is to evaluate global market opportunities for U.S. firms, and that will be due at the end of August 2017, and it will be publicly available. And then we will follow that with two other reports, one, the first one focusing on business-to-business digital products and services, which will rely on a confidential survey of businesses where companies can describe to us the trade barriers that they feel they're facing and what the impact is. And that would be a place for companies to work with us and try to give us some objective information with which we could make some broader statements that are not company specific at all and very much confidential to trade negotiators and to Congress on really what the economic impact of these barriers is on U.S. companies. And it's always a tough job to call up companies and ask them to really fill out our surveys, but we were very careful with the data, and it actually, if the past is prologue, was able to really inform the TPP negotiators' agenda, and I think will help in formulating the agenda in the next administration. So I would urge you all that are in the field to think about working with your teams to work with us as we come to you. And then finally, there'll be a report that is delivered in March of 2019 talking about business-to-consumer digital products and services trade. But call that to your attention. I have copies of the letter if anybody is really interested in more details. But we rely on input from the private sector to help us do our work and very much appreciate it.
Meredith, you mentioned it briefly, but have you had good cooperation in the past with companies and industries being willing to say, here's what we're facing in these countries? The fact that it's confidential certainly helps, but
yeah, and that will help. I think, you know, it's funny because this is a sector that's been very quiet, really, in talking about the TPP, talking about what government can do for them in trade negotiations. So they are helpful and talk to us, but there's certain companies that are a little more reticent than others, just that they don't see the reticence to their business. So I think the fact that it's confidential and that the importance of communication with government on some of these issues is helpful, I think, to U.S. negotiators. So we do hope that people will be willing to contribute.
Excellent. Thanks. We're going to go to questions in just a minute, so you can start thinking of those. I wanted to hit one more topic first, and that is the concept of digital protectionism, Susan, that you brought up earlier. The United States has been quick to label some countries as protectionist. Can you say a little more about what that concept is and why those allegations might be difficult to show in the real world?
Thank you. So a couple of things here. First of all, the ITC came up with a definition in its part one of its report. I think that would have been 2013, Martha, am I right? And defined it quite broadly, because it not only included traditional notions of what is protectionist, like content requirements or server location requirements. That fits along the lines of older concepts of regulatory protectionism. What I think is going to be hard to discern is things like cyber theft when information is stolen. Because once you start down that line, then do you go to false information or misinformation, I guess I meant to say? Could that be a barrier to trade? Could the Czech Republic, which now has put in a unit, according to the New York Times, to fight misinformation from Russia and other places, could they say that's a barrier to trade under the WTO? We just don't know. Another thing, the U.S. has said in several of its trade barrier reports that too much privacy regulation can be a barrier to trade. But it also says an inadequate regulatory system, that's the wrong word, please forgive me, for privacy, it can also be a barrier to trade because you need strong privacy protections for consumers and businesses to have trust online. So I think we need time to develop a consensus as to what truly is trade distorting and actionable under trade agreements. And so, you know, I think recently I tried to set up a study group of people to just think about this, and we couldn't find agreement. It'll be interesting to see how this develops.
Let's again go back to basics. I don't think anyone would disagree with, as you pointed out, the narrow definition in the TPP. I think one can agree on all of the things that are done there. When you get then to the other questions, they're not covered in the TPP, and they will just have to work those out, it seems to me. So I don't disagree. I think those are great points, but it doesn't really impact what's in the TPP as it was negotiated.
Talking about the larger context for trade.
I know, WTO, but I'm just talking about, be
example,
careful about,
the Google,
we know.
Case, when Google asked USTR, I'm sorry, this is my first public address ever, please. So when Google in 2011 asked USTR, and the EU also said that they might challenge China regarding censorship of websites, and you know, when Google had to move its server to Hong Kong. These are issues that could move forward in a trade dispute. And, you know, the WTO, because it's technologically neutral, but it doesn't have any explicit language related to this, we just don't know.
Actually, I'm glad you raised that for a point about we have a report coming out, actually, this week. That actually says the new administration should, there are WTO rules that we think, the censorship rules and the Great Wall violate WTO. It's not entirely clear, but we are arguing that they should go ahead, I argue, there's no AEI position. I argue in the report, we should go ahead and test it. There are indications in earlier cases that the WTO would look with favor on a case that really challenged the sweeping censorship that the Chinese are, that have economic implications as well as privacy and human rights implications. So I think that would, that, again, though, what we've got on the table now in terms of the TPP is not involved in that, I think.
Any other comments before we go to questions? All right. I'll throw it out to the group. If anyone has a question for our panel, if you could state your name and who you're with, and also who your question is directed to, if you have someone in mind. Sir, please. Sorry about the microphones. It's been a tough hour. Thanks for bearing with us.
Baron Soka, Tech Freedom. I'm also trying to figure,
so
is it working?
You,
okay. Sir. I'm also scratching my head trying to figure out what's going to happen here, and I love the idea of the digital single market for North America, for example, but it seems unlikely given the general attitude towards trade, unless, as Claude suggests, maybe there's a radically different approach to digital. So with that in mind, my question is, just during the panel, Senator Lee announced his new bill, the Global Trade Accountability Act, which would parallel the RAINS Act, which was just passed by the House. It would require that Congress sign off on any major trade action, which includes raising tariffs as well as canceling or renegotiating trade deals. So, in other words, it would require Congress to sign off if NAFTA were to be canceled or renegotiated or whatever. And that seems like a great thing to me, and probably everyone in this room would support that. And the thing that astonished me about his piece today in Forbes is he claims that the president supports the bill. So what do we make of that? Is that just Trump today, and Trump, you know, in 3 months might think something differently, or is this the the general insistence upon restoring a separation of powers trumping digital trade, or rather Trump's protectionism. So what do we think will happen on that bill? Any particular concerns about it?
Well, I think I know the bill. And I think, as far as I can tell, Senator Lee has really sort of split the baby or drawn a fine line. The thing that would bother me about the Congress getting back involved in trade is anything that would really undercut the president's ability to negotiate. They already have hedged him or her in a way, which I think is fine. He has to go. The Congress has, we should remember, the Congress has a full and final authority here, okay? And so they've granted the president authority, but they've actually taken back some things over the last few years. In other words, he has to come back to them. They've already had with trade promotion authority, gives the president a set of priorities which he has to negotiate. He has to also check in with them. I think that's about as far as I would go there. I think what Lee is getting at is the back end, if you will. Once an agreement has been negotiated, who should be involved in changing it? And I think the Congress, they can play with this language and probably will, but I think Congress is on good grounds of saying, look, you know, this is our authority in the first place, and we granted it to you. Some of this we may want to be in with you. As it stands now, the president has full authority will keep this to withdraw. But there's got to be at least consultation and some view for the Congress to get in it, it seems to me. I don't know whether others have followed this legislation. All right.
Yes, please.
Thanks. Steve DelBianco with NetChoice. I've heard Dr. Barfield talk about WTO action to go after nations that inhibit the free flow of information. And I talked to my members at NetChoice about that, and they reacted by saying what my kids say about my grandfather, it takes too long to get moving, and there's no teeth involved. So, Claude, I welcome your exhortation on this. But I mean, I would ask, what can it be paired with? It can't be WTO alone. We need a whole bevy of things to go after because it will take too long.
What the report we have really aims at China, and it's two parts. One, reluctantly, as someone who's kind of a militant free trader, and I believe in unilateral disarmament in trade normally, reluctantly, though, I think we will argue to the administration that we ought to move toward a policy in China of reciprocity. And that means you cannot do it. I think you could be careful about breaking trade rules there, but investment rules around the world, whether it's the WTO or bilaterals or whatever agreements, are much looser. And so there's a good deal of leeway that an administration will have in terms of invoking market power here. And just finally telling the Chinese, we will not stand for this if our companies are kept out, either by a formal legally or some sort of informal set of negotiations. So I'm not suggesting it's just the WTO, but I think that is one sort of arrow in our quiver, I think.
Can I just comment briefly on Tim's point? Tim, the Supreme Court takes forever, right? We have to go through all the court systems. And that's part of the trust credibility thing of the international organization. But should a nation such as China lose that dispute, and China has always complied with its WTO losses, it has always complied with WTO rulings. So I actually think that would send a quite chilling signal, even though it might take 3 years, you know, or it could take less. But again, what that would say is that access to information and cross-border information flows are paramount. That is the essence of trade and ideas. And it could have a hugely powerful message. I just don't see the United States under Trump as the country sending that message. I just don't think that's their shtick. But I hope I am wrong. I pray I am wrong.
Other?
Yeah, just really briefly, I think that we're talking about China right now, but I think we should also be looking at some of our other trading partners. And we're talking data flows, but I think we should also be talking about some of the unbalanced copyright provisions that are being proposed around the world. So, you know, China's obviously a longer conversation, big conversation, but right in front of us, the EU with the digital single market and some of the copyright proposals, I think are ripe for consideration in terms of future enforcement actions.
I'll jump out of my moderator chair for 30 seconds to say there's been a lot of talk about use of Section 301 of the trade laws. Ambassador Lighthizer is very familiar with those laws, particularly, as Claude said, in areas like internet or investment where it's not, if there's not an overt violation of a WTO agreement, there might be more discretion there for the United States to take action and negotiate. If our new president is a negotiator, that might be appealing to him. So I know we're cutting into lunch hour, but maybe one more question. Please, in front.
That's Milt.
How about if both of you ask your questions and then we'll have the panel respond?
I hope that you can have time to handle it. So the first thing I have to say as an observation is that there seems to be nobody on the panel who's kind of a Trumpian anti-trade person, which is, you know, great in terms of ideological congruity, but kind of bad to get a representation of what's actually going to happen here. My question was about the kind of the elephant in the room with digital trade agreements, which is in fact copyright, which was finally raised by Ari. It seems to some of us that copyright, stronger copyright protection is not really a trade issue per se. It's about the U.S. linking access to their market to satisfy a special interest group that wants stronger, longer monopoly rights on copyrighted information. And this has been a major factor undermining support for digital trade agreements. So do you think that's correct, that we're simply linking things for political purposes, or is there really a legitimate role for increasingly strong copyright protection in these digital trade agreements?
Lily Schultz from Department of Commerce. My question is, I've heard that even though when Trump first came out about being against TPP, that it would still go through with other countries. Is that correct, or what do you think the rest of the world is going to do even though this administration says no?
Okay, all right, do you want to start on the copyright or?
Yes, yeah, quick on, okay. On copyright. So I think that we've seen for many years that copyright and trade agreements has been unbalanced and one-sided, and TPP was actually the first agreement that did look at the full framework of IP. And so I do think that from my perspective, it does belong in trade agreements, and as long as we're looking at the full balance, that's the right direction to go.
Did you have a thought, Susan?
Yeah. So on what happens next to the rest of the world, because the U.S. is important, but we are not the entire world. I mean, there is talk of TPP going forward and even being renegotiated to include more of Asia, possibly China, which would leave the U.S. out in the cold. And while many on this panel may say that's unlikely, I mean, just remember the Asian Infrastructure Bank that seemed unlikely until China started it and many of our allies in the rest of the world jumped in and, you know, the U.S. was the one party left out. So definitely keep an eye on TPP and the rest of the world.
Quick thoughts down here.
There is an alternate Asian regional arrangement that the Chinese are pushing, the so-called RCEP. And certainly there are some countries in the TPP that are also in that. That will continue. I think the other thing, though, to keep in mind, and I don't know whether this will happen or not, but I and others have urged the other members of the TPP, besides the United States, to go. You could not have a TPP as it's now structured. You have to have the United States. But there's nothing to stop them from having their own arrangement, which is the TPP without the United States, if they negotiate it. And my point being to them is that they have already taken the political flak internally for any concessions that they have made. They know that this is a much better agreement than the alternative that the Chinese are pushing. So it would make sense for them to go ahead and ratify something on their own, even without the United States. Whether they will do this, I don't know. Most of these countries, I think with the exception of Vietnam, are already in their internal processes going ahead to ratify the TPP, hoping that the United States will or would come to its senses down the road. But they could work on that. They could do this on their own, actually.
All right, any last thoughts, 30 seconds most, from anyone on our panel? Maybe we'll continue this discussion at lunch. Great. Well, I think we had two pieces of breaking news in the last hour and some great input from our panelists. So if you'll please join me in thanking them for their time. Thank you.
No, but RCEP has no regulatory.
Well organized.
Who's?
Who's,